I don't think it's the strong suit of directors to look as nice as the actors are. I have a friend who makes a point to curse at least once during every Q&A, and I asked him why. He's like, I don't know, just, it's cool. I was like, all right, see, I sound like a 12-year-old.
Where did this journey start for you?
Well, I started off volunteering in the Himalayas, and I actually signed up for this event called the Eco Podyatra. Mm-hmm. And I had just graduated from film school, so I, you know, sort of a modest undertaking. I thought, oh well, I'll make a film about it, and that's sort of the genesis of it. At the time, I didn't realize that the film would become this epic undertaking, that we'd be caught in blizzards, that we would have emergency rescues, and the severity of the environmental problem out there was not yet apparent to me. So a lot of this sort of happened, it developed as we went.
So were you thinking that it was, because having gone to film school,
yeah.
Did you feel it would be easy? Did you feel it would be...
Yes, because I was kind of an arrogant asshole when I got out of film school.
Well.
I thought, hey, I've got this USC degree and I'm awesome. Mm-hmm. And I got there and I was completely humbled. And mm-hmm. I had to throw everything I learned out the window for a large part of this production. And the cinematographer was a local monk who's from the Himalayas, who never got altitude sickness once like all the other Westerners. And it was like we were in the Wild West with limited gear, using solar panels on, we didn't even shoot on HD because there wasn't enough solar energy to sustain hard drives and laptops. So we shot like Sandra Def Powell's, like going back in time and shooting a film.
So that wasn't a statement, that was circumstance as much as anything else?
Circumstance, yeah.
Yeah.
And I mean, we lost at least 20% of our tapes just from the damage and physicality of being on a trek.
Mm-hmm.
You know, we had like weather damage. We were crossing rivers we weren't anticipating. We hit snow. So like our box of tapes at the end, it was just covered in dirt afterwards. but we were very grateful that we had any footage at all to show for it. So it was something where first we were just glad we finished and everyone was alive and okay.
Mm-hmm.
And then secondly, we were glad we had any footage at all to share.
So where, how much of your mind is in the filmmaking and how much of your mind is in the trek?
A lot of it was in the trek because it overpowered everything. I mean, I had B camera, I was just a DSLR, and mm-hmm. that actual like 4 pounds was unbearable. Mm-hmm. To give you an idea, there were days where I didn't want to drink that much water because it would have added to my body weight. So it was so strange. We were at 17,000 feet on a lot of the shoot.
Mm-hmm.
So you can imagine just like walking to the next destination was hard enough as it was. And knowing that I couldn't afford to get sick and leave the trek and come back made it very challenging.
Mm.
Yeah.
So was the experience, were you engaging the experience of trekking in the moral experience of it in a significant way as you were doing it, or were
Absolutely.
You distracted?
As far as the environmental message of the trek goes, it's funny because I never really identified with being an environmentalist prior to this trip and this film. I grew up sort of jaded by the message, and I knew it was good to care about the environment, but it never really sunk in to this degree in my life. And the reason is, it's horrifying. Like, you get out there, you see this pristine culture that's largely nomadic and agricultural and peaceful and traditional, and then you see a layer of trash strewn everywhere, and then they're drinking out of the water sources that's polluted with styrofoam and plastic, and they had no idea it was poisonous. So we would go in and we were doing education village to village, which was one of the main purposes of this podyatra, was education. And these villagers were literally burst out crying on the spot. They were horrified. I grew up being hit with this message over and over and not listening to it. These people were hearing it for the first time in their adult lives and realizing why they've been getting sick so much in the last 5 years. And so they were absolutely horrified by this, and they made immediate changes, and they've now, a lot of these villages have banned plastic altogether from coming in. and they started doing filtered water as a local business, so that tourists who come in aren't, they don't feel the need to bring bottles and to purchase bottles to bring in. So the immediacy of the environmental issue out there was just a really, it was an amazing wake-up call to me, and to bring that back home was so impactful. And that's what I hope the film will serve to do. It's really a film for the Western world. And it's, the film has become this symbol of the environmental movement for people in the Himalayas also. But, you know, as someone who's from here, I very much wanted to share that experience with people in the Western world.
From here being the Western world? Or
the Western world, yeah. As in, Hollywood is the Western world. but yeah, in the Western world, as in a lot of the developed countries that are facing environmental issues on a mass scale, and knowing that I think seeing an example of where even the smallest bit of environmental impact is having a huge devastating consequence on people, it's just a really good reminder. I think we're really removed and buffered from consequences. So we could drop plastic on the floor and never think about it again. Mm-hmm. Whereas if you're in the Himalayas, you put some plastic in the river, people downstream are now getting sick immediately. And this region actually provides the fresh water for half the world's population. So if this were to get out of control in this area, you can imagine it would trickle down into India, into China, and all of these parts of the world that drink water directly from the streams.
So where are you from, actually?
I was born and raised in Los Angeles.
So you're actual Angela. So you're an Angelina who went to USC? And
yeah.
What made you think about being a filmmaker? Besides being in Los Angeles, I guess it's
It's funny because I never wanted to be a filmmaker growing up. I guess I was so close to films, it never even dawned on me. but yeah, I mean, there's something to be said about sharing stories, and I've always loved to write, and I'd always loved photography, and making films was sort of a next step. It wasn't until late college that I really started to get into editing and storytelling. And I just fell in love with it, and there's no turning back now.
So how did you make, I mean, what was that transition like? I mean, it's not like everybody falls into USC film school.
Oh, well, I mean, the transition to film school are coming out. I mean, it was interesting because you have people there from all over the world, not just LA, obviously. I was one of two people in my class, I think, one of two or three people that was from LA.
One or two, three people from LA that's from LA.
In a class of like 40.
I mean, the whole city.
It's true.
It's a very rare.
It is true.
At least on the west side.
Yeah, exactly. So it was great, actually. It was a really diverse group, and we all became very close. It was amazing.
So were you at USC for something else and then ended up in film school? Or?
Oh, no. I mean, I did my undergrad in Boston. I studied philosophy, philosophy of science. I was really into sci-fi. And then, and my interest was largely in editing. And then when I got to USC, I got really into writing and directing. And then I went through the doc program there. Mm-hmm. So I had mentors like Mark Harris and Kate Amend and all these amazing documentary filmmakers. And so I went through that program and that was it.
So did you have enough to cut on this movie as an editor?
It was hard. Yeah, it
editor
was hard.
First?
It was hard. It was very hard. It was like a film ratio because of how much we were able to shoot on the trek and the fact that we lost a lot of footage. And the camera kept shutting off at that temperature and altitude. I just met with a cinematographer. I saw him in Nepal a few months ago, and he was actually describing to me some of the shots that he tried to get and when the camera shut off from the temperature and the battery's just dying all the time. So yeah, I mean, it was very difficult, but obviously had enough to go on.
Usually it's the opposite problem when you're doing a documentary is you have so much footage, you have to try to pare it down.
It's a blessing and a curse to have a lot of footage. Yeah. And it seemed with having a little bit of footage, it's a blessing and a curse because there were many times we wished we could have articulated more about the trip. But we're also just really grateful that we had any footage at all. We had someone go in and it fixed some of the frames even. We had an animator go in and up converting everything at the end and matching everything was quite a challenge.
Yeah, we were a couple of years ago, I guess, and I'm completely blanking on the guy's name, but he did a Middle Eastern documentary with a 5C and took, he said it last, maybe if he was lucky if he got, 8 minutes at a time because between the sand and the heat, it just was impossible, even though the camera was, you know, functioning as well as it could be expected to be functioning.
Mm-hmm.
That the circumstances just weren't good.
Yes.
It's but not
then,
so easy.
Yeah, but then that's the type of stuff that needs to be captured and shared because it's so hard to capture. You don't already see a lot of it. So a lot of the footage that we have is stuff that people have never seen before. And, you know, our cinematographer, he now has an award for best cinematography, and he had no prior professional. He's been shooting, but nothing professional. I mean, he's a monk by I guess by trade. But he.
What do you call that? Yeah, profession?
But he studied a lot of National Geographic videos, and his heart was in it, obviously, because this is a cause he really loved.
Mm-hmm.
And he delivered. Sometimes he would trek a day or two in advance just to get one shot from an adjacent mountain. And we didn't have any heavy gear with us, so he would be he was in the trees, you know, he was all over the place. He did 2-3 times the distance as the rest of us.
Wow. Well, there is something very intimate and natural about the footage. I mean, there's beautiful, beautiful stuff, but it also doesn't feel like it's been posed or...
No.
You know, it has a slightly rough-hewn edge, which makes it feel more normal, I guess.
Yeah, in a way, I don't think we were... you know, it helps that we were sort of people who are of the trek and of the area. So it wasn't, I guess, as invasive as maybe some other things that I've seen as far as... Because we got a question at a Q&A recently that was like, oh, did people feel uncomfortable with you shooting them? And the answer is not at all because, you know, we were all very familiar with each other. Mm-hmm. And the DP is one of their own kind of thing. And so people were very much themselves on the track.
They weren't of the steal my soul with a camera.
No.
Some people still are, amazingly enough. So would your instinct next time to be... You want to go trekking to just go trek without a camera or to plan better with more cameras?
That's interesting. Right now, I would like to say I'd love to go without cameras, but if I really were to go, there's no way I wouldn't be grabbing every camera in sight because it's just sort of in my blood now.
Mm-hmm.
But it's so weird. A few shots in the film are off an iPhone even because, you know, it's really hard to not shoot something once you're used to making movies.
Mm-hmm.
Everything is... I was in line once waiting for something and I started shooting a movie off my phone. I edited it into a 3-minute short, you know? I mean... It's really hard not to shoot, especially when something is that unique and that beautiful. So I would say, yeah, it's inevitable that I would want to shoot it.
So were you surprised by the attention the film started getting after you put it together?
On some level, yes, and on some level, no, because the event itself is so epic and sort of newsworthy in and of itself, and it has caused this huge environmental movement across the Himalayas. So on that level, it seems natural that people would want to know about it. And then from a filmmaking point of view, yeah, it's surprising and humbling because it's my first feature and you spent 2 years in post thinking you're crazy, you know. So of course it's been extremely validating and also humbling to see, you know, your work out there.
So what was your 2 years in post like?
It was pretty brutal. It was pretty brutal.
Why
but,
brutal?
Because it started off, I think, as a more modest undertaking, and then it grew over time. So it started off as a short, and then it grew to a longer short, and then I thought it was done. I flew it to Nepal to show it. So a lot of the people in the film, it's a very Buddhist region, so a lot of the people in the film are local nuns and monks. So I flew it out there to screen it with about 500 nuns at one point, just to get their okay on it and make sure that, you know, we had their blessing and everything. And the response was so strong that we all sort of decided this should really be a feature film. And this is something that we're really going to push to a larger international audience. And so at that point, we came back and redid everything from scratch and started working on that project. So it really felt like it was sort of reincarnated many times over before you get to what you see now.
Not many people test screen with nuns. It's a very
And it's a very interesting crowd, especially these nuns. So you'll see in the film, but the Kung Fu nuns, they're really sassy. One of the person who started this trip is called His Holiness the Galang Drukpa, and one of his causes on top of the environmental cause is gender equality. So he started training all his nuns in kung fu and encouraging them to do martial arts, which they all do now. I literally just saw a nun break brick with her bare hands a few months ago.
Which many people who were into Catholic schools think they already could do.
Yes. Yeah.
Just with their minds. They
exactly. So yeah, they're a tough and sassy crowd, you know. So it was really great to spend time with them and to share the film with them, obviously. They're a big part of the film as well.
So is there, where are you in all of this as you give up years of your life, you know, 2 years trying to cut this thing and change it and make a short and longer short?
Right.
Your career is just starting, really. So where do you put yourself in all that? Are you just focused on the work and not really worrying about what's next or what you're going to be doing with the, you know, next 6 months? Or
it's funny you should say that because, you know, it's like being a filmmaker, there's so much uncertainty, or any kind of artist, really, there's so much uncertainty. And the main message of the film and the tagline on the poster says, take a step. And that's applying to the larger environmental movement, which is, it's not about, you know, it's about doing one little thing and believing that that will add up to a larger movement, right? And so I actually repeat that to myself every day in terms of career and where I'm going. It's really easy to get overwhelmed. This is like a limitless industry. There's so much potential, but it can be so overwhelming. So I try to focus on what the next little piece is gonna be and just hone in on that. So that keeps it manageable and feasible, and things seem to be moving forward for me.
So you're working on the next thing already?
Yes.
Thinking about it?
Yeah.
How long has it been since you locked this movie?
The main event took place in 2009.
Right.
And we shot some pickup after that, so the production went on past that. And then we added a little bit of footage from the most recent Podyatras. It's now an annual event, so we did that recently.
It will never lock, is what you're saying.
Never.
And just keep on expanding until
picture it's lock like is a myth. Event. Yeah.
So is there? I mean, do you have distribution of?
We've had some distribution. We did a theatrical release in Asia,
right?
And it went very well. And we are in the process of doing deals here, and we're working on it basically, but we don't have any formal deals in play yet.
Is it, do you think that's because it's a narrative that has a meaning? That's not just the kind of clean, obvious documentary that?
Well, I think the film is different than your average documentary. It's not really your traditional talking heads documentary with B-roll, and it's not even your traditional social issues doc. This is not, if you walk in thinking it's an Inconvenient Truth, you know, you're gonna be disappointed. It's not a list of facts, and this is not science, but it's an experience. And I do think that's one thing that's missing from the environmental sort of, as far as films go, the genre of environmental films, is you get a lot of fact-driven or gloom and doom kind of movies, which is fine, and there is a place for that.
Yeah.
But this film is really an answer to that, and I think this is a missing piece of the greater message, which is it's a very emotional, experiential, and uplifting piece about the environment.
Mm-hmm.
And you can be a little bit silly. You know, if you've seen the film, you could be a little bit silly.
Mm-hmm.
And you can have this experience of an environmental message that, you know, it makes you feel good and empowered and that you can do something. And it's not, you know, you don't have to run and hide in a cave for the next 20 years, which, you know, I know a lot of people, it's funny because I know a lot of people who want to see the docs that are about social issues, but they don't. And I always ask people why. Like, they're like, oh, that looks like such a good movie, but I'm not going to see it. I can't watch it. I can't handle it. And I know exactly what they mean.
Mm-hmm.
Sometimes it's so painful to get that information, but we need to get it. And then I think, again, this film is doing something a little different in the sense that you're going to get the information, but it's not so heavy that you can't come watch it. It's a very family-friendly movie. It's a great conversation starter, and it's everything that I think it's accessible.
Well, it's more like you're on the journey than you're looking at the journey.
Exactly. And you're on it and you're feeling it. I met a woman yesterday who comes seeing the movie twice already for our theatrical release. Mm-hmm. And I said, why did you come back again? I'm just curious. And she said, I just want you to know I didn't come back for the message. I came back, she's like, I came back for the emotions. And I was like, what do you mean? She's like, I just needed to feel that. And she said it made her feel encouraged. It made her feel good. It made her feel like she could go out and do something. So I think it's the equivalent of a pep talk, maybe. Mm-hmm. We're an audience award winner at a festival called the Feel Good Film Festival. And I think there's a connotation sometimes that, like, if something feels good, maybe it's softer. But mm-hmm. I think that's absolutely what we need right now in terms of this particular social issue.
So you went into this, you were not really prepared to make a feature film out of it originally, and it's evolved and it's evolved and it's evolved. Is this, you know, going out and selling it and going out and getting a distribution and all this, that part of it, the business part of it?
Yes.
Is that part not is what you expected? Is it frustrating that you don't have the same kind of power to just do it and make it happen without having to have somebody else jump on board, or?
Not necessarily. I mean, I actually look forward to this process now. I mean, we've been to 33 film festivals. We have 10 awards, mm-hmm. and now we're in a position to take it to a larger audience. So I'm actually really excited about that piece of making a film, the whole business side. It's something that is a little new to me as someone who has only directed and not produced as much. Mm-hmm. But it sounds like a really exciting and inevitable piece of the larger life cycle of the film. So I can't wait for it to go out there.
So you like all of that. You're now getting interested in this as well.
Very interested, yeah.
You're not on a money trek.
I'm on a money trek, yes. You could put it that way. And I think it's inevitable. I mean, film is an expensive medium and it's a lucrative medium. I mean, it's sort of built in, it's built into it, you know, it's sort of inevitable. So why fight it, I guess? You may as well embrace it.
So would you encourage your other classmates to go out and make something and not think about it too much?
I would, because this is something I could have stumbled into and that I am so grateful for the experience. And I think there's a risk, especially early in your career, of getting too fixated mm-hmm. on what you think you should or can be doing. And people are, you know, you kind of have to be open to the accidents, the happy accidents that could happen too, and follow where the, you know, follow where the world, universe is sort of leading you, I guess.
And are you, is the cause of, is the activism and the ecological activism now guiding you? Is that now a high priority for you?
Yeah, it's incredible. One of the main messages of the film is it's an exploration of what kindness means in the modern world and how you can apply kindness in the modern world and not look weak for it, which is a weird thing because I think being kind here, let's say, mm-hmm. where I grew up, being kind is considered kind of a weak thing. You know, if you help a bug, if you see a bug and you take it outside, and someone's probably going to make fun of you for it. But when you're in the Himalayas, and you'll see in the film, everyone, you stop a line of 700 people so you could move some bugs out of the way. That's actually considered a very manly, fierce thing mm-hmm. to do, and you're a very strong person if you're willing to do that. And it's admired. And anyway, I've been really inspired by that message. So I can say that not only environmental issues, but the issue of how to bring the message of kindness in this sort of new light is really important to me. And I can, my next several projects are sort of based on that concept.
So not traditional, you're not going to become a part of the traditional industry right away.
I hope
to be. Since kindness is not a part of it.
Well, not always, and sometimes it is, but it's a little sappy and namby-pamby, you know. I hope that connotation goes away one day. And so I do hope to be part of the industry and be part of the commercial industry eventually and to be able to bring that influence, you know, a little bit and see what happens.
I mean, maybe it's kind a little edgy.
I hope so. I like to think I'm a little I like to think of my style as being a little girly but kick-ass. You know, like you can be a little bit edgy and just, I just want to be myself basically and bring that voice to the table because I'm really not into doing more of the same, but I do think there is an audience for sort of a new way of thinking about things.
And how old are you?
I'm 32 years old.
You're 32. My God, I was gonna thought that you were 24.
Thank you. I know I look younger than my age, which is good and bad in many cases, but
you're still embracing life at 32. It's a good thing. You've been battered around and given up on positive things.
No. I hope not.
It's a rare commodity in this town.
It is. And, you know, we got to shake it up a little and see. I think most people, I've been speaking to a lot of, I spoke to a panel to high school students recently. Mm-hmm. And, I'm speaking to elementary school kids next month. And I do think it's something weird function of age, but younger people don't usually struggle with this. Like, mm-hmm. they do tend to have a fresh take. And they have very unique voices by nature. I think it's the older you get and things start to kind of like solidify a certain way and you kind of lose sight of it. But I think having a playful nature is really important to keeping things fresh and accessible and interesting. And, you know, I hope more people would embrace their playfulness and understand they can still be serious and playful at the same time.
It's that's one of the better messages of, you know, all of them.
Yeah.
That's a tough one to get across sometimes.
It's very hard.
But the film has that spirit, so.
I hope so.